Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening, welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Uzma Jafri. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Friday, the 30th of July. India reports highest number of COVID-19 cases in 3 weeks. Taliban assassinations of Afghan pilots worrisome, says US government watchdog. And residents in Nepal rush to get shots amid vaccine shortage. And now for all the details. India reported 44,230 new COVID-19 cases on Friday, the most in last 3 weeks. The latest evidence of a worrying trend of rising cases that has forced Southern Kerala state to lock down amid fears of another wave of infections.
India on Friday reported 44,230 new COVID-19 cases in the last 24 hours, the most in 3 weeks, taking the infections tally to 31.57 million, with 423,217 deaths so far. The worrying trend of rising cases has forced Southern Kerala state to reimpose COVID-19 restrictions while announcing a weekend lockdown, during which only essential services will be allowed. The pace of spread of infections in Kerala, with an active caseload of 155,327, is the highest in the country. During the last 4 weeks, 7 of Kerala's 14 districts reported an increasing trend in daily new infections, government data showed. Health experts have called for faster vaccinations to stave off another big surge.
Lockdown.
Meanwhile, tourist influx increased in Kargil Dras region in the Union Territory of Ladakh on Friday after relaxation in COVID-19 curbs. Ladakh is one of the most visited tourist destinations by adventure lovers who ride motorcycles in the Himalayan hills. Earlier this month, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, along with the Health Ministry, had expressed concerns after videos of crowded tourist destinations emerged on social media. Experts are worried that such unleashed behavior could be a precedent to the third wave.
The spokesperson of the Tibetan government in exile, Tenzin Lekshe, has welcomed U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken's meeting with a representative of Tibet's spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama, this week, calling it a significant move. He hoped that Chinese leaders understand that Tibet issue is important and is of international importance, and they should have wisdom to seek dialogue.
Tibetans living in exile in India have welcomed U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken's meeting with a representative of Tibet's spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama, in New Delhi this week. Blinken met briefly with Modup Dongchung, who serves as a representative of the Central Tibetan Administration, also known as the Tibetan Government in Exile. Terming the meeting as a significant move, spokesperson of the Tibetan Government in Exile, Tenzin Lekshe, said that this is a clear message to other countries that they should also speak about Tibet issue and human rights issue when they meet Chinese leaders. He hoped that Chinese leaders understand that Tibet issue is of international importance and they should have wisdom to seek dialogue.
For the Tibetan, it is not to antagonize China, but to resolve the issue. So in this effort, I hope that Chinese leaders will understand that Tibet issue is important and it's an international issue, not just for Tibet. So therefore, they should have a wisdom to seek dialogue as early as possible.
Meanwhile, reacting sharply, Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson termed the meeting a violation of the U.S. commitment to acknowledge Tibet being a part of China. The Tibetan government in exile and the Tibetan advocacy groups have received a boost in international support in recent months amid rising criticism of China's human rights record. Chinese troops occupied Tibet in 1950 and later annexed it. In 1959, Tibetan uprising saw violent clashes between Tibetan residents and Chinese forces. The 14th Dalai Lama fled to neighboring India after the failed uprising against Chinese rule. The Dalai Lama, the supreme Tibetan Buddhist leader, established a government in exile in India.
In news from Afghanistan, the U.S. Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction in its quarterly report has raised concern over Taliban assassinations of Afghan pilots as the Afghan Air Force reels from a surge in fighting. At least 7 Afghan pilots have been reportedly assassinated off base in recent months as the U.S.-led international troops withdraw from Afghanistan.
Taliban assassinations of Afghan pilots this month mark another worrisome development for the Afghan Air Force as it reels from a surge in fighting, the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction, or SIGAR, said in a report. The US government watchdog in its quarterly report to Congress, which was released on Thursday, broadly portrayed an Afghan Air Force under growing strain from battling the Taliban amid the US withdrawal, set to complete by August 31. At least 7 Afghan pilots have been reportedly assassinated off base in recent months. Amid the surge in violence, Taliban insurgents are quickly seizing territories once controlled by the US-backed government of President Ashraf Ghani, raising fears they could eventually try to take the capital, Kabul. Meanwhile, U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken said on Thursday that Washington was in talks with other allies on the possibility of relocating Afghan interpreters temporarily, and the subject came up during his meetings in Kuwait. Many Afghans who worked with NATO forces fear reprisals from the Taliban as U.S. troops depart.
In news from Pakistan, active cases of coronavirus crossed 60,000 mark in Pakistan on Friday as the country is witnessing a rapid surge in infections dominated by Delta variant, and its poor health infrastructure is under extreme pressure. After a sluggish start, the government has ramped up its nationwide vaccination drive and has imposed strict measures to ensure people get inoculated.
Pakistan hit another record high day for COVID-19 cases, with the active number of cases crossing the 60,000 mark on Friday. The South Asian nation, for the third consecutive day, reported over 4,000 new infections, while deaths rose by 86, taking the confirmed cases to 1,024,861, with 23,295 fatalities so far. Pakistan has seen coronavirus infection soar, dominated by Delta variant, and its poor health infrastructure is under extreme pressure. After a sluggish start, the government has ramped up its national vaccination drive. The target is to touch 1 million doses a day, the country's planning minister Asad Umar said on Thursday. Over 27.8 million have now received at least one vaccine shot, while only 5.9 million have been fully vaccinated out of a population of 220 million. The government on Thursday said it will ban air travel for anyone without a COVID-19 vaccine certificate from August 1 and will require all public sector workers to get vaccinated by August 31st, along with a host of other restrictions. Teachers and students above 18, public transport and retail staff will also be required to get vaccinated by the end of August.
Moving on to news from Nepal. Nepal's COVID-19 cases tally neared the 700,000 mark on Friday as it battles a devastating second wave of the pandemic. The country's massive inoculation drive has been hampered by shortage of vaccines, while the government races against time to immunize citizens before another wave hits the Himalayan nation.
Nepal's COVID-19 cases tally reached 690,642 as of Friday, after over 2,330 new infections were logged in the last 24 hours, while the death toll climbed to 9,807. The infection rate in the Himalayan nation now stands at 23.62%, which experts say is a cause of worry. Meanwhile, hundreds of Nepalese were on Thursday seen lining up in serpentine queues outside vaccination centers in capital Kathmandu, facing the scorching heat and uncertainty over the chance to get the jab amid a vaccine shortage. The long queues have become a common sight throughout all vaccine centers as people rush to get the jab fearing a third wave. Haste of people and communication gap between authorities and people has been fueling the confusion in existing situation, authorities said. Nepal had earlier introduced an online registration system to book slot for vaccination, but the government reversed it for easy and equal access to vaccine. More than 1.3 million people who have had first dose of a vaccine are awaiting a second dose as the government scrambles to procure shots. The government has pledged to vaccinate a third of its people in the next 3 months and every Nepali by next April.
In news from Bangladesh, heavy monsoon rains have pounded Rohingya refugee camps in southern Bangladesh, destroying dwellings and turning settlements into fast-flowing rivers overnight. Rohingya Muslims in a refugee camp in Cox's Bazar describe how flooding and landslides left homes damaged and totally covered with mud.
Rohingya Muslims in a refugee camp in Cox's Bazar, Bangladesh on Thursday described how flooding and landslides left homes damaged and totally covered with mud. At least 6 Rohingya Muslims, including children, were killed and several others injured on Tuesday after heavy monsoon rains triggered landslides and flooding in refugee camps in southern Bangladesh, officials said. Nearly 1 million Rohingya live in crowded camps in the border district of Cox's Bazar, the world's largest refugee settlement, after fleeing a military crackdown in neighboring Myanmar in 2017. Rohingya refugees mostly live in shacks made of bamboo and plastic sheets that cling to steep, bare hills, and flooding has further worsened their living conditions.
Indian boxer Lavlina Borgohain created history as she assured India of its second medal in the ongoing Tokyo Olympics. Lavlina defeated former world champion Chen Nianchin of Taiwan in the quarterfinal of women's welterweight to storm into the semifinals. She will now take on Turkey's reigning world champion Musina Sarmaneli in the semifinal on August 4.
Boxer Lavlina Borgohain assured India a bronze after storming into the semi-finals of the women's welterweight category in the Tokyo Olympics after defeating Chinese Taipei's Nianchin Chen in the quarterfinals on Friday. Lavlina defeated Chen by a split decision of 4-1, assuring India its third medal in boxing at Olympics. She also became the second woman after Indian legend MC Mary Kom, bronze in 2012 London Olympics, to qualify for a medal round. Lavlina, in a virtual press conference organized by the Boxing Federation of India after her win, said that she is not going to stop here and will be gunning for the top prize in women's welterweight category.
Abhi jaise main jo mera routine main follow karti hu usi ko main follow kiya jaise मतलब फर्स्ट मैच के बाद मैंने नेक्स्ट के लिए खुद को नॉर्मल जैसे मैं करती हूँ ट्रेनिंग के बाद हर कुछ मैं जो रूटीन है मेरा उसी को फॉलो किया मैंने दूसरा इतना कुछ किया नहीं मैं इसके साथ पहले ही मैंने 4 बार हार चुकी हूँ तो उसका गेम मुझे पता ही था तो मैंने उसका वीडियो भी नहीं देखा बस मैंने सोचा कि मुझे बस अपना गेम खेलना है।
Soon after her victory, people in her hometown in Golaghat district of India's northeastern Assam state came out on the streets to celebrate. They danced, clapped and cheered Borgohain. Some of them beat drums and sang traditional Assamese songs. Lovlina will now take on Turkey's reigning world champion Buzenar Surmaneli in the semi-final on August 4.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now, our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/sasianewsline and follow us on Twitter at sasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time next week. Have a great weekend. Good night.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.